Hello, everybody. Thanks so much for tuning in to this live Q&A. My name is Liz Eggleston. I run Course Report, which is a resource for choosing the coding bootcamp that's right for you. If you haven't looked at Course Report yet, this is my one shameless plug. We have thousands of alumni reviews, I think over 7,000 now, of bootcamps around the world, and tons of advice on choosing the right bootcamp for your needs. So check out Course Report. And on Course Report, we talk a ton about how to choose a bootcamp, how to get into a coding bootcamp, the application process, and then how to be really successful at a coding bootcamp. But today, we are talking about something that every bootcamper goes through after they graduate, which is the technical interview, which is sometimes feared, sometimes people look forward to it. Either way, today I am joined by two instructors from one of the largest, I think most well-known boot camps in the United States, which is Dev Bootcamp. So welcome to Mark Seemers and Anil Kulkani. Thanks so much for joining us. Mark and Anil don't just train hundreds of students to go through technical interviews. They've also been through it themselves, so they are the perfect people to answer all of our questions about technical interviews. So just to give you an idea of what we're gonna talk about, we're gonna start by talking through what a technical interview actually is and the types of questions that you might be able to expect. And then Mark and Anil have actually put together three things that your technical interviewer is looking for that don't have anything to do with getting the answer right. And that's something that we can all use. So thank you so much, Mark and Anil, for joining us. Do you want to introduce yourselves and give us a little background?
Sure. Hi, my name is Anil. I have been at Dev Bootcamp for only a few months now. So this is all part of this new experience for me. Prior to that, I've been in software industry for about 7 years. I started my career at Microsoft, worked on Windows, so definitely have been through those full, you know, 8 to 5 interview loops. I remember those well. And then after that, helped start a company, its name is Textio, and so we've grown that to from, it was all of us in a shared office space, and now it's a thriving company, and then made the jump to be a teacher. So,
and Anil, you're in Dev Bootcamp Seattle, right?
That's right. So we're cool. In the Seattle office. We've been here for about a year. Have a great staff, and one of the things Seattle does particularly well is we place students, or we help students after they graduate get great jobs, and so we're proud of our success here.
Cool. Yeah, Microsoft is in Seattle, so not a terrible connection there.
No, not at all.
Mark, tell us about yourself.
Sure. I'm a teacher in the San Diego campus for Dev Bootcamp. I came from a different background, a business background, so I had a similar, you know, don't know what the tech world is all about. And I've been on both sides of the interview. Similar to Anil, I worked at a very large company, so I've been through the interview process there. And I worked also at a very small web company where the development team was 2. So I've been on both sides of the technical interview, coming from a different background. And now I help people here prepare for those kind of things as well as their career.
Cool. I noticed in my very brief LinkedIn stalking that you are an IU grad, Indiana
grad. That's right.
So go Hoosiers. Me too. cool. So, all right. So let's dive into these because you both teach at Dev Bootcamp. We could talk about teaching forever, but today we were going to talk about that technical interview. So first, just tell us, like, what is a technical interview? What should somebody expect during that technical interview? You mentioned an 8 to 5 interview loop. Like, are they super long? What are we looking at?
Yeah, thanks for asking. So I definitely think it's kind of unique to the industry how it works. So typically, how the stages work is once you get to the actual technical interview, it might start out with potentially a group conversation where you're kind of meeting everyone that you're going to be talking to. May or may not happen. And then as you go through the day, you'll probably spend about an hour on average with a different person. And so usually you just kind of go off into a conference room or their office, and they'll just ask you 1 to 3 questions, and then you work through them. And you'll get some amount of feedback, but it really is kind of like a on the spot, kind of have to work through a challenge, and then you move on to the next one, where usually actually the questions can be wildly different from one interviewer to the next. Each person will have their own favorite style of question or thing they're trying to get at, and then when you're that's all done, you'll say goodbye for the day, and then the group of interviewers will get back together and kind of discuss how you progress throughout the day.
So there's some culture fit, there's some technical piece of it. Is there anything else that's different than kind of like a traditional interview that I think we've all been through, where you go through your resume, talk about your background, and then leave?
Right, I think Mark can speak a little bit to the traditional interview and how it's different, but one comment I'll make is that unlike maybe in an interview where, like, when I wanted to get a job outside of tech, I'd be like, these are the things I know, this is what I can do well. A tech interview is not so much about what the right answer is, but a lot of it's kind of how's your thought process, how you approach problems, and how you work with each other. Because as an engineer, that's what you spend a lot of your day doing, is not knowing what the right answer is, but finding your way to it. And so the interviews are trying to suss that out.
I like that. That's a really good distinction.
Yeah. And to add on to that, the main difference, I think, is twofold. It does cover culture and all the other things that you said. The primary focus is on the technical piece, though. And one of the big differentiators is, with other interviewers, you might talk about other types of interviews. You talk about your past and what you've done in the past, your accomplishments. When I was coming out of business school, the STAR interview, situation, task, action, results, was like the new hotness then. And in this one, it doesn't matter what you did in your past. It's, here's a problem in your present right now. How do you work through it? So that's really the main difference, is you're not going to be recalling something that you did to try to talk about yourself. You're going to be presented with something and try to display how you work through a problem that's right in front of you.
I love that. Do you think, should a bootcamp grad be like surprised or hesitant if they are not asked to do a technical interview? Like, is that a red flag for a company, or?
That would really depend on what else is involved. You know, did they get an overnight code challenge, or do they have a good GitHub account where people can see their code? If someone hires you without seeing any of your code or any of your thought process, I would consider that a red flag. But if they have other mechanisms, you know, you can use HackerRank or like different online tools to more automatically assess technical skills. But the absence of any technical assessment whatsoever would to me sound like they're either desperate or they don't know what they're doing.
I think, so we're going to talk a little bit about how Dev Bootcamp like prepares students for the technical interview, but once you get a technical interview, like, how should a candidate prepare? Is it cool to like ask the interviewer for guidance ahead of time, like what technologies or languages they should be brushing up on? Is that not cool? Like, what goes into your kind of before the interview process?
So I'll take the first part of that, and then I'll try to delegate part of it to Anil. I think the best thing that you can do to prepare is to whiteboard in front of other people, like your friends, whatever, because the biggest sticking point is going to be stage fright, you know? And if you get comfortable with that, or if you're not comfortable with it, it doesn't matter how well prepared you are to implement algorithms. If you freeze up there, it doesn't matter. Now, as far as asking questions about specific technologies and things like that, Anil, when you were giving interviews, would you provide any guidance to candidates, or would you try to keep that close to the chest?
Yeah, so definitely we want, as somebody giving an interview, want the candidate to be put in the best position for success. So sometimes what'll happen, especially in a smaller company, is if your company uses certain languages, and it's usually not just one. So it might be like at Textio, we were primarily Python and JavaScript. And so we told candidates, here are some languages we would prefer you to use. And that being said, if they chose to do it in a different language, that'd be fine. There would just be more questions that'd be asked back and forth. But as somebody, as a candidate, I would definitely make sure you get that guidance ahead of time and saying, hey, what should I expect? I think it's totally fair to ask, like, how can mm-hmm. I best prepare for the interview?
Cool. Yeah, it's great to get that advice from someone who's been on the other side of the hiring process. It's really cool. So what types of questions can somebody expect in a technical interview? I know this can be a little bit difficult to predict, but like in y'all's past experience in the last, 5 to 10 years, what kinds of questions would you expect to see in a technical interview?
Yeah, so this is something that we can paint a broad stroke to give you a few categories of things, but by no means should it be a checklist. Every company is going to focus on different things and have a different style. But generally, someone will have you try to implement a well-known algorithm just to see if you can dig into the pieces. And a well-known algorithm can be as simple as find the maximum in a list. Yeah, we have the list here. So bubble sort is kind of the simplest sorting algorithm to implement, but they might choose a different one like qsort or merge sort, finding min and max. So things that are solved and standardized, but they want to know that you understand how they work and you could implement them on your own if you needed to, so that you have some idea of what the internals are going on inside. And then Fibonacci, that one's not as widely used as min, max, and sort, but again, it's a very well-known solution, and just knowing how you can work through it. And then they might ask you to switch, like, okay, you did that iteratively, now do it recursively. Just to see if you can make that mind switch and think about problems in two different ways. So the well-known algorithm is one.
Are those bubble sort and finding min-max, are those things that you would be like talking out or whiteboarding or like pair programming to show them that you know the answer?
Yeah, I can maybe take that. I think that some of that reflects back on the company. You asked a little bit about red flags. And so actually for me, if somebody asked me to just whiteboard bubble sort without any prep, I could totally bomb that question because it's not something I do on a day-to-day job. And so good companies will put you in scenarios that let them evaluate how you're going to do on the job. And so if they do a lot of pair programming at the company, I would totally expect the company to want you to pair with an employee. If they're doing something that's heavy with linguistics or machine learning, like you would see the questions more tailored towards that. But companies nobody's figured out a great way of doing it. So sometimes it'll be on the whiteboard. Sometimes they'll hand you a laptop. Sometimes you'll bring your own. So I really think that is pretty varied.
Cool. Yeah, that's a good point. You can kind of use the technical interview to figure out like the style of the company and if you would be like a good fit there, things like that. It's nice. Okay, so you can be asked to implement a well-known algorithm. What else could you be asked?
Okay, so the next one is maybe not a well-known algorithm, but one that you probably haven't seen. Now, FizzBuzz is like the canonical example of this, but now it is well-known because it was used so often. So you won't, if you actually get FizzBuzz, that's a red flag. Like run for the hills if someone's asking you to implement FizzBuzz in a technical interview. But something like this that's kind of nonsensical that you may not have seen ahead of time, so that when presented with a brand new problem that you have no background, how do you process working through the issues, right? How do you come up with what the expected outcomes are? And do you take the opportunity to refactor? Can you catch like any weirdness about the algorithm where it's mostly straightforward, but then there's one little bit that you have to take care of? So something that gives you the opportunity to display that you can think through a brand new problem rather than you've studied bubble sort a lot.
Mm-hmm. And to kind of a expand on what Mark said, because I totally agree with everything, is like a lot of times it's related to something you've done. So it's not completely like they wouldn't ask you to solve a rocket science problem if that's not your background. But I remember for me when I was interviewing at Microsoft, one of the questions I had was to solve a maze. And like that's something I've done before, but it had some, and I can't remember now, but there was some twist on it. Like you could only go right three times or something like that. And so it was given this little bit of a tweak, how could you kind of take some of this foundation that you know and work through the problem to solve this specific task?
Cool. Okay, cool. So you could be asked to implement a well-known algorithm, a trivial algorithm that you may have never seen before, hopefully not FizzBuzz. How about brain teaser?
Yeah, so this is the one where there's maybe a little bit of crossover if you've done interviews in the consulting world or other places where people want to get an idea of how you think through problems. And this one, they may not require any code at all. Just give you a problem. One that I got was like, if you stacked $1 bills from the street to the top of this building, you know, how do you figure out what volume that takes up and would it fit under your desk? You know, like,
yeah,
what assumptions do you make? What prior knowledge do you use? How do you make all that work together to come up with a solution? Now, do they care if it's right or not? Probably not. They just want to know that you make some educated guesses, use your background information, and figure out how you work through the problem. And like it says, it probably won't be strictly technical. Like you won't write a function. You won't have to know syntax. You won't have to whiteboard it. You just have to talk through how you would figure out the problem as a human.
Yeah. I remember at Living Social, everybody asked how you would build a ball pit in the office. That was like the very funny brain teaser.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay. So that could be like a completely non-technical question. And then finally, a language specific question. I feel like this might be the scariest type.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it again kind of depends on the company. Mm-hmm. And I think that sometimes it's a bit of a kind of a cop-out, like when somebody's trying to come up with a question like, oh, can you implement, how do you do a copy constructor in C++ as an example, where the idea is to say, kind of test your depth of knowledge in a language. And then a lot of times it's our company is heavily based, say, on Rails or whatever that technology stack is. And in order to be productive, we feel that it's an important skill for you to already come with. And so normally those jobs say like X years of experience in whatever, you know, required. And so it's a way of kind of sussing out, oh yeah, you say you've worked on this technology or this language, but how much do you usually know?
For sure.
And I do think it ties into some of the earlier questions where sometimes it'll be trivia based, kind of like, can you describe something that everybody should kind of know if you've done it enough? Or it'd be like, here's something that you probably haven't seen before in this language, but it should be kind of related and you can work out the idiosyncrasy of it.
Like at Dev Bootcamp, y'all are teaching Rails and JavaScript. Do you have students who will go to a Python interview or an interview in like a completely different language and have to get through questions like this? Or can you just kind of say, can you give like an I don't know answer?
So I can speak to some of that. And I'm sure with Microsoft and Amazon up in Seattle, you have some examples too. But yeah, we have plenty of people that go after C# jobs, Java, et cetera. I mean, one of the things that we do is we try to teach you to learn how to learn. So picking up your second and third language will be an expedited process. And yeah, absolutely. We have people that get jobs straight out of here in a completely different language. And in fact, a lot of our final projects, I should say like none of them are in Rails. Everybody picks to do, you know, like an iOS app in Swift, or they use a tool like Ionic. You know, they're hungry to get something new and build something a little bit different than what they've done throughout the curriculum. So yeah, absolutely. People can pick up and research a language if they know ahead of time, you know, this is a C# shop. So I'm going to spend 2 weeks, you know, brushing up on that, learning that, and then hopefully be prepared for the interview.
Along those same lines, what's the best way to handle a question that you just flat out do not know the answer to? Do y'all have advice for that? I've heard from a couple of different employers, kind of like different advice. What do you advise students to do in that situation?
It's funny, I had a conversation about this kind of yesterday. What I think is that for any question, there's one part of it is being able to know where your own boundaries are. And so if you say, if you go into something, yeah, obviously it's, you know, da 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 da, and you have no idea, that for me as an interviewer would be a red flag. So I think there's a lot of value in saying, listen, you know, I've never used this thing before, or maybe I know, but I'm blanking out on it today for whatever reason. I think it's totally reasonable to start with that. Mm-hmm. And then my suggestion is that kind of no matter what the problem is, somewhere back, might be really far away, is there's some familiarity with it. So at the end of the day, it's on a computer, right? So hopefully you can at least start there. And then you find where you're comfortable with, and then just start exploring outwards towards that direction and ask questions and say, hey, I could use some, you know, is this right? Maybe this would work. What do you think? Mm. You know, and so still apply the thought process and like how you would solve the problem, similar to Mark's question about the dollar bills. Like, obviously I have no idea how to answer that, but still being able to say, you know, here's where I could start from, you know, maybe these are the assumptions I'd make. Is this even the right approach? Right. And still make an attempt, but start from what you know, and then go outwards.
Yeah. So still showing your process.
Yeah, exactly.
Smart.
Yeah. And I'll add on to that. Just think about, if you're asked about a language or a framework that you don't know, you're probably being asked by someone that has potentially years of experience. You're not going to be able to fake your way through that. They're going to detect that right away. So definitely own your ignorance, right? There's no one that knows every language or framework or every piece of any language or framework. But to Anil's point, like, you have a starting point. Say, like, I don't know that as well. This is how I would do it in this technology that I do know. You could even ask for some guidance, like, how would I change the method signature to match, you know, this new language? What do I need to do to make sure that it's a right return statement? Do I have this type of data structure available? You know, showing that you can hopefully take your knowledge that exists and then learn how to apply it would be important, mm-hmm. but do not try to fake your way through it. It will look much, much worse than admitting your ignorance.
Yeah.
Much, much
worse. This just reminds me, I was talking to an employer one time, and maybe you suggest this, maybe you don't, but he said that he had given a question, the interviewee had no idea what the answer was. They like tried to get through it. And then afterwards, like after the whole interview was over, he went home, and the next morning the guy had like an email from the interviewee, and he had like done a bunch of research and figured out like how he would actually solve that problem. And that was his follow-up to the interview. Yeah. To the interviewer. I thought that was such a brilliant idea, and I think that he got the job, and I think it was an actual like bootcamp grad as well. I feel like you're always going to run into questions like that you don't know. So. Mm-hmm. Okay, very good advice. Okay, so I put a call out on Twitter asking for questions about the technical interview, and this is one that we got. I think that y'all have kind of answered this in the last few minutes, but the question was, how could a job candidate be asked to answer questions? So like whiteboarding or pair programming, take home assignments, like, is a technical interview always going to be going into the office, sitting down, pair programming, and, you know, leaving the interview? Or what are other kind of like formats that you could see an interview in?
Yeah. So, I mean, there's the traditional go in, whiteboard in front of, you know, 1 to 3 people and maybe spend a full day. Other people have different levels, right, where they might give you an overnight assignment where it's totally remote. There might be a phone interview where they ask you some simpler questions that can all be verbal, you know, about some different concepts. And then if you get through those screenings, then they do the more in-depth on-site thing. Going to be totally company dependent. And as more of these tools are available online to provide challenges remotely, where there's automated testing and all these other things, those will be incorporated. So with the remote things, there's less pressure, right? It's more like what your actual job will be like when you have a few hours and you can research the answers, you can look at Stack Overflow, you can do all those things that you will do on your job, versus when you're on the whiteboard and it's just you, a marker, and your own thoughts. The technology is evolving and companies have varying level of adoption. That's something that you can definitely, if you get to the point where they're asking you to do a technical interview, or even before that, you can ask, you know, what's the process? What's the first round of technical? What's the second round of technical? But there's not a hard and fast rule. A lot of places you still eventually have to do the in-person whiteboard. So it will be hard to avoid that entirely.
Cool. Wait, y'all, what's the craziest interview that you've, or interview question that you've ever been asked in a technical interview? Can you share that with us? And how did you like handle it?
So do you want to go first, Anil?
I'm trying to think of a good one.
Okay. So. I'll use the one that we discussed a little bit offline. I got the Die Hard question. There's one where I think it's Bruce Willis and Samuel L. Jackson are in Central Park and like a bomb's going to explode and they have a 3-gallon jug and a 5-gallon jug and they have to get exactly 4 gallons. And I remember getting this question and being like, why don't I remember what they did in Die Hard? Why can't I remember what Bruce Willis did? But then I realized, you know, like if I just gave the answer, they would just know that that was a trivia question for me. You know, like how did Bruce Willis do this in Die Hard? But since I actually had to work through it, it was way more helpful for them. And actually, though nerve-wracking, like more fun for me.
Yeah, cool. It's kind of a fun question.
Yeah.
Anil, can you think of one or do you want to pop in later?
The few questions I remember, I interviewed for Bing and at Microsoft, at least some of the times when you switch teams in a large way, they make you go through kind of the full interview loop again. And so one of the questions was along the lines of more or less implement Bing, like how you have a request and you have, you know, some data and it needs to come back and really fast, like how would you approach the problem? Would you have one server or 500 servers? And like, so just having to stop back and kind of think about what it even means to for a search engine to work and like how that could possibly happen was pretty crazy. And then a follow-up to that was like, okay, so now you have some, want to make some search sort algorithm, but because you're working on billions and billions of data, your traditional ones won't apply. So kind of how could you solve it and
come up with a new search algorithm?
Yeah. Dang. So the question, like the expected answer wasn't to like have some perfect thing. I mean, companies are formed on these kind of ideas, right? But the idea was, can you speak to at least your constraints and what you can't do at least, and maybe come up with some ideas going forward?
Yeah.
That was a tough one.
Yeah. That's a really intense question. It's so huge. Okay, y'all. So we talked a lot about like the questions that you can expect, but it's not just the right answer that an employer is looking for. So y'all have actually thought about this and compiled your advice into 3 points. Do you want to share that with the crowd? Okay, cool. Curiosity. Yeah. How do you show curiosity and what does that even have to do with being a developer?
Yeah. So if you come in and you're genuinely curious about how to solve a problem and why you would solve it and all the different ways to refactor, they know you're going to be excited about the job. And so even if problems are hard, you're going to be a net benefit to the team. Like even if it's just bringing some energy into it, you know, if you lack some technical expertise at the time, they know that your curiosity is going to drive you. They're not going to have to micromanage you to make sure that you learn, you know, you pick up the newest version differences between some package that they're upgrading, that your curiosity is going to drive you to pick up the things that are going to make you successful, right? If they leave the interview and you've spent the whole time, you know, just sort of checking off boxes, trying to get it right, they're going to say, will they even like this job? You know, this is what they're going to be doing all day. If they're not excited about it, you know, their lifetime is going to be limited. Their engagement in the job is going to be limited. The creative process, all of those things. If you leave the interview and they're more excited than when they started, you're in a really good place.
That's very good advice. Oh, okay. I think this is a huge one, communicating your thought process. And it's, I feel like we've kind of been, talking through this, as we talked about all of those technical questions that you could get, how important is actually like showing your thought process in the interview?
Yeah, it's crucial. And I think just going back to like the curiosity point Mark was making, like this whole industry is about being creative, and so unlike a math formula or where there's like one right answer, it's a lot of CS is all about art, and it's how you can solve things however you want. And so for me, when I'm interviewing somebody, I'm not looking to say can they see I need to take the 5-gallon jug and add 3 things or not to it. It's like, can confident am I that you're going to be able to solve the problems that we're going to face. And so by communicating the thought process, it's not saying yes, I have the skills to get this exact answer, but it's I have this foundation where in my day-to-day job that I can take these new challenges and be able to solve them without getting stuck and without needing to be micromanaged, like Mark said. And for me, the other part of it is that in the same way that nobody knows every language, nobody will know every perfect part to every problem. And so by showing your thought process, you show what you're good at. Some people will really love the either visual parts of a problem or like the performance parts. And some people will like approaching things from the top bottom and saying like top down, saying like, okay, overall I know how this is going to work, and then I'll figure out the smaller pieces. Some people will like the other way. They'll say, well, I don't know exactly how it's going to work yet, but I know I'm going to need this small piece of it, so I'm going to figure that out and then work my way up. These are all great ways to solve problems, but showing and demonstrating that the whole process along the way is so much more valuable than the actual answer. I honestly, for the most part, I don't care if the final answer is right, if the code runs. It's all about how you got to that point.
Yeah, and I'll tack on to that piece. Any company where you're going to work with other developers, which is going to be almost all of them, you're going to get stuck and you're going to need help, or you're going to be working on a problem with a team. And if you can't communicate your thought process, your other team members have to read your code, read your mind, figure out what you were trying to do, and take all that time, energy, and mental focus. But if you can communicate your thought process, you can expedite getting them to where you are, and then they can properly help or implement their part of the solution. And if that's disconnected from them, then you run into delays and frustrations and all kinds of things. So this is the part where knowing how good your potential is technically is really fantastic, like Anil talked about. But this is more the culture part. Like, how are you going to help the team, and how are you going to allow the team to help you?
Definitely. You can almost like mimic your workflow in the office and like what it will be like to actually work with you once they hire you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Awesome. Okay. And then finally, yes, ability to break down a huge problem, like come up with your own search algorithm into small parts.
I can start with that one. So, it all kind of ties together, I think, to what we've been talking about, and when you get stuck, because we all will get stuck, it's, okay, can I have a process for going forward? And a lot of that process is like, well, I don't know how to solve the whole thing, but what can I solve? And if, or what do I need to research first so I can even be able to tackle this problem? So even that step of like, well, I need more information. Now you've just made the problem a little bit more focused. And so being able to it's not only to break down problems, but show that you can take your initiative for yourself and saying, okay, I'm not that I'm stuck, because everyone gets stuck, but how am I going to get unstuck and not just spin my wheels and not get anywhere? And it's a learned skill. And frankly, there are a lot of really talented senior developers that I've worked with that they're great until they don't know something, and then they just freeze up. And a much better approach would be to say, okay, here's my steps for kind of unblocking myself. And to what Mark said, how can I pull in people and talk to them? Mm-hmm. And so the last thing I'd say about this subject is again, there's no right way to break down a problem. It's not, there's no five-step process that you have to go through. You should take whatever strengths work best for you. If you're a visual person and want to brainstorm things, you should do that. If you're a person who likes to research, if you're a person who likes to find some small related thing and build out where it's like, make the approach that works for you, but definitely see that somehow you need to take some big thing and make it into some smaller pieces so that you can make progress.
Yeah. Wonderful. Okay, so curiosity, communicating your thought process, breaking down a problem into small parts, those are all amazing pieces of advice. I think the one string throughout is that the thing that technical interviewers are not looking for is that like perfect answer, perfect solution, right?
Yeah, I mean, there's no one is a human compiler. So if you're writing on a whiteboard, they're not gonna highlight every single syntax error that you have, right? It doesn't even matter if you give the correct answer. You know, most software developers, you're wrong 100 times until that last time when you're right. So the perfect solution doesn't matter. It's that you have the process, the communication, and the curiosity part is really about the motivation to work through those things. So the perfect solution is an afterthought.
Cool. Okay, y'all. So I want to talk a little bit about how Dev Bootcamp actually prepares students for the technical interview. I know y'all are both working with students all day, every day, getting them ready for their first jobs as developers. So maybe you can talk through a little bit about like what's available to students once they graduate, and maybe even before that, when they're getting ready for their first job.
Yeah, I know Mark has doing some great things in San Diego, but wanted to start out with a few of the things that we do in Seattle. We have interview credits. So there's a service where you can go on and get practice getting with technical interviews, and you'll get feedback. So
cool. Like online?
Online, yeah.
That's awesome.
Every weekend we have whiteboarding for where one of our partners from Microsoft comes in, and then the students will get practice with technical interviews. And so we have some more resources kind of along those lines. But I think more broadly, the thing that DBC gives is in the same vein of it's not the right answer. And so what DBC is all about is like build the foundation and like learn how you can take some knowledge that you have and apply it to somewhere else. And so when you get these questions and it's something that you haven't seen bubble sort before or whatever, you don't just stare at it and say, well, I don't have that exact piece of information, so I don't know what to do. I think that DBC and actually the whole bootcamp space does a good job of preparing folks to be able to take whatever they know and know that it doesn't have to be perfect, but it can get them started in a direction and then they can go from that.
And I'll add on a little bit to that. So the careers team, all the campuses have a career developer on site. Up in Seattle, they have Lacey, who is just killing it, doing great things. Kevin works down here. And so we have partnerships with, here we have like Intuit has been to our campus 3 or 4 times. and there's other local San Diego companies that we get those connections with. So that's kind of the careers team. There's a global team as well, working on more global initiatives. Our curriculum, we don't jump straight into web development. That's not until the second phase of our program. The first week is 100% algorithms. So you do things iteratively, recursively. So when you're studying for a technical interview, it's not the first time that you've broken down an old school, like, algorithmic problem. You haven't just done web development. And then beyond that, we have our space is open to alumni and to the public in general. So people come in, they can whiteboard in front of each other. And then in San Diego, we do something. It's either Marker Monday or Whiteboard Wednesday, because I love alliteration. And our current students will whiteboard in front of the rest of the class. So you're talking between like 10 and 20 people, so that when you're in front of two or three, it's maybe less nerve-wracking, right? So you get a little bit of that on-site experience, and then we have a lot of support staff and a lot of community involvement.
Awesome. Yeah, I love that Dev Bootcamp has like actual employer partners come to the campus and like maybe even do interviews, do like interview questions. I think that is such invaluable practice, right?
Yeah.
Okay, my last question, I know y'all need to get back to your day, keep teaching people. So as people who have been through the technical interview before, we just talked about like some of the employers that Dev Bootcamp works with. What's your advice to employers who are hiring bootcamp grads? Like, do you think that they should be tweaking the interview process a little bit for bootcamp grads? Like, should there be more focus on the portfolio? Like, what kind of advice would you give to an employer who's like, I want to hire from bootcamps, I just don't like know how, or, you know, should I be like changing my whole process to do so?
That is such a good question. And it's one that I really wish folks would broadly ask, because people will come up with solutions rather than trying to take the same old hammer and apply it to the new problem, because the industry is changing and the companies that change with it faster will win, and the ones that don't will not have the talent they need going forward. But what the bias that I kind of see is that, so your traditional, you know, 4-8 year program, if you will focus a lot on kind of the underlying math, and you'll get this very, very kind of deep and layered approach, which makes sense if you have, you know, so much time and energy to devote to something. But like for me, when I came to Microsoft, I didn't actually know how to write software. I kind of knew the theory behind it, but so I could speak really well to like some algorithm on and like the running time of some program. But if you actually asked me to make a Rails app, you know, I wouldn't know how. And you compare that and contrast that to a bootcamp grad, where their strengths coming out of it are they make things. You know, they're hands on. They can actually take a problem and say, okay, how can I solve this? Which is a great skill. And then the second thing bootcamp grads do really well is, how can I learn by myself and saying, okay, I need to know this. And it's almost like, if you remember the original Matrix movie, where they need to like learn how to either ride a motorcycle or pilot. Yeah. So they just download it and it works. And like, honestly, like that's kind of how it feels for me as an instructor, where when I learned React, it was months of frustrations. And then here we did it in 3 days and they're already making their final projects on it. So those are the strengths. And I think a good employer will look and say, like, I don't actually care if these candidates can make the super mathy, you know, search algorithm. Like, if I need that kind of person, you can hire those kind of people. But there are so many jobs out there where you have a lot of tasks that are going to have real consumer or benefit to your company, and they just involve solving problems. And so I would tailor the interviews towards how can you work with people and how can you grow? Because the candidates, or excuse me, the students that I see that leave DBC, that have the best ability to learn and grow and make things are the ones that do the best. And it's not necessarily the folks that come out of here the most technically strong in a classical sense.
Amazing advice. Mark, do you want to add anything?
Oh, yeah. So to Anil's point, it's like the difference is kind of theory versus pragmatic implementation. And I would hesitate to say that any employer should change their interview for a bootcamp grad versus a CS grad. I think they should change their interview for the job they're trying to fill. If you need an algorithm writer, fantastic, ask about algorithms. If you need someone that can develop applications, ask about how to develop applications. So we talked about some of the typical technical interview questions. That's not an endorsement, like that these are good. You should ask FizzBuzz, you should ask BubbleSort. I actually think those are terrible to ask a web developer because you'll never do that on the job. What other industry do you ask about things that you do zero times on the job? And David Hanmeyer Hansen put out a great tweet, I don't know, a couple months ago that was like, I would fail to implement BubbleSort. I look up stuff on the internet all the time. You know, I'm also like a multimillionaire creator of Rails and Basecamp.
Totally.
So I would say that it should be adjusted for the task at hand, not for where the person is coming from.
Yeah, that's really good advice. Like maybe just tailoring the interview or your entire interview process in general to like finding problem solvers versus finding people who can like solve trivia questions.
There was a time and a place where people needed to implement sorting algorithms, but they're so widely available in libraries now, it would be silly to write your own anymore.
Yeah.
Do we have the ability, real quick, to add resources after this?
We totally can. I'm going to publish this on our blog and we'll put it in the YouTube channel. And so we'll totally put in any of the like resources that y'all want to add afterwards. And that was going to be my final question, was just if you have any of your favorite resources for practicing like technical interview questions, anything like that in general. And we'll totally link to them in the final piece.
Got it. So my first plug is to Mark's tweet. Example is there's a person whose name is Lauren, and she put up a Git repo called Hiring Without Whiteboards, and it's companies that don't use the traditional whiteboard interview and then to ask, to get to your earlier question, like what do they do, and then it'll say what their process is instead. So I would encourage using that as a resource to see what companies you want to interview for.
Amazing.
Yeah, and go ahead, Anil.
Okay, and then to practice for whiteboard or technical interviewing in general, the resources I've used in the past are there's a site called Project Euler, which is pretty mathy, but then I've used that to learn new languages and kind of solve things differently. Now there's a lot more cooler stuff, like there's HackerRank?
HackerRank, Code Wars,
Yeah, HackerRank, Code Wars, those are all ones that I've heard people who have gotten jobs like mention that they use, so can't hurt. Incredible. Well, y'all, thank you so much, Mark and Anil. I cannot thank you enough for joining us and sharing all of your tips on how to ace the technical interview. I feel like I have learned a ton, and I know that this is going to be really helpful to all of the bootcampers who are watching, and maybe even to an employer who's watching. So if you're an employer who wants to hire from a coding bootcamp, you know what to do now. And thanks to you for tuning in. We'll publish this on our YouTube channel with all of the resources that Anil and Mark mentioned in the video. And then if you're watching this and you have questions, just leave them in the comments below and we'll make sure that they get to the right person. Thanks so much for tuning in. We'll see you in the next live Q&A.
Thanks.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.